About Dogs on BCTV is supported by the Berks County Kennel Club and by the Berks County Dog Training Club.
Good evening and welcome to the Berks County Kennel Club's program, All About Dogs. Hi, I'm Pat Monk, your host, and this evening we have two interesting breeds for you. We have a Shiba Inu and we have a Shar Pei, two Oriental type dogs. No, they don't have slanted eyes. I don't think they have slanted eyes. So anyhow, they are Oriental dogs. Our guests are Sharon Roble, and she is the one with the Shiba Inu, which is this little red one on the side here, and Darin Cox, and he's the one with the Shar Pei, the one with the wrinkles. So I think we'll talk to Sharon first about, actually, I had both these dogs on the program, not these dogs or these people, but the breed on many years ago. In fact, the pay wasn't even recognized. That's how long ago it was that I had a Shar Pei on the program.
That was in 92. So
it's been a long time. So anyway, suppose you tell us what a Shiba Inu is, and what does the name, does it mean something?
Yes, in Japanese, the Shiba Inu means little brushwood dog.
Little brushwood.
Their purpose in Japan were game flushers. They would flush birds out of the...
Oh, so they're hunting dogs.
Yes, that was their original purpose.
Oh,
and
wow.
Also small boar and the smaller... they would also drive smaller bear on occasion, too, but mostly that was for the Akita.
Well, yeah, I would hope so. I mean, these little guys, I mean, they could worry a bear, but my word, you know, one swipe and they're done.
Yes.
Wow. I didn't realize that. I didn't know they did the same job. Well... Then Inu means dog.
Yes, okay. Inu is just the Japanese word for dog. There are Japanese Spitz breeds all in their Nippos club over there, all have Inu after them. It just means Akita dog, Kishu dog, you know.
Because
there are several different Japanese Spitz breeds. The Shiba is the smallest, the Akita is the largest, and those are the ones we're the most familiar with.
Oh, okay. Yeah, because I know there's a Tosa as well.
Tosas are not Spitz breeds, though,
okay.
And they were a mixture of that's a Mastiff-type dog. They were used for fighting.
Oh.
Yes, that was one of their purposes. They were like war dogs.
Okay.
That's the Tosa, whole different thing. It's the Japanese Spitz breeds are the native Japanese dogs.
Okay. Yeah, I guess almost all the Japanese dogs have the curled tails, don't they?
The Japanese Spitz do, and I guess a couple of the chin.
Ones, yeah.
Yes.
That's exactly right.
Exactly.
How about that? They like that.
Well, it's cold in Japan. Maybe there's a reason for that.
I don't know. Yeah, they can hide their noses behind their tails, right?
Yes.
So then here in the United States, then do they still have that instinct, that hunting instinct?
The breed can be very prey-driven.
Okay. So, which makes it easy to train, by and large, because it would be interested in food or toys.
Well, for the most part, the training can be tricky for some people. The breeders are doing a better job on that because they're a very primitive-minded breed.
Uh-huh.
It is the breed, studies done by National Geographic, this is the breed that has the DNA closest to the wolf.
Really?
They're the most primitive, purebred dog.
Huh, how about that? And yet they're so small.
Yes, but they're mighty. They're pretty tough. This one might not be the example to prove that. But
is this the dog that climbs the tree?
They climb over 6-foot fences rather quickly.
And
you can't catch them even when they're old, let me tell you that.
Oh my word.
So you have to have a secure area for them.
Yes. So definitely a fenced yard.
They can be mischievous and a little bit, they're independent thinkers.
Okay.
Quite like a cat would be.
Okay. Do they use their front paws then a lot as
yes,
well?
Yes, they do. They will hit each other, tap each other when they want to be pet. That's a typical dog thing, but they tend to use their paws a lot. They will also clean their paws like a cat and rub it across their face.
Okay. How about that? That's really interesting. So how popular is this breed? I mean, it's a little dog and you think, people like little dogs now, but this might be a little much for a person who's expecting a nice, calm little dog.
Well, it depends where you get your dog, of course, but I would not recommend a Shiba as a first-time pet for anybody. They can be a challenge.
Okay.
That being said, there have been a few times that, you know, first-time pet owners have gotten Shibas and done quite well with them because they were willing to put in the work. Socialization is extremely important with this breed because they are quite primitive-minded.
Okay.
So they can react more on instinct. Unless they see it's to their advantage not to.
Yeah. Hence the socialization.
Yes.
So as far as grooming, now this is a double-coated breed, correct?
Oh, yes, yes.
And obviously needs to be brushed because it does shed, yes?
Yes. In fact, she's getting ready to now. As you can see, this is all puffed out.
Uh-huh.
And
so she's getting ready to shed her coat.
Yes, in the spring. It's a very heavy, heavy-coated breed. As a rule, there are some Shibas that have a little softer, but it's still a plush double coat.
Okay.
So
twice
a year you're blessed with dust bunnies.
Yeah. We all are. Anybody who has a dog and it's like, oh, well, does it shed? This dog doesn't shed. It's like, yes, it does.
But it is easy because it's the undercoat that's coming out.
That's exactly right.
It vacuums up quickly. It doesn't stick in your sofa.
Yeah. And so many people say, well, I have a long-haired dog, and so many people will say to me, well, do you shave it off in the summer? It's like, oh, my gosh, no, you know, I don't shave it off. But so many people do. You know, they just shave the coat off.
And that's actually a very bad thing
that's
to
exactly
do.
That's exactly right.
That's their
exactly
insulation,
right.
too.
Yeah. So do they only come in this coat, or do they have a longer coat, a shorter coat, or is it only this kind of coat?
No, her coat is pretty much as a little bit more profuse than what you'll see in the average Shiba.
Okay.
You want a distinct guard coat that may be about 2 inches longer than than the undercoat.
Okay.
You don't want them to, you know, to have like lots of tufts. She has a little bit on her feet, and that's okay. But you don't want to have any like more length than maybe two and a quarter inch on any part of the body.
Okay.
It's not supposed to have a long draping coat ever.
Okay. Colors that they come in.
Okay, the accepted colors for showing us this color, which is the red.
Okay.
It's a clear red. They come in a red sesame and black and tan. The black and tan pattern is one that it's just like a tricolor. You'd probably see it in several different types
of
dogs.
Like a Doberman? Or?
No, because they're always going to have a white. They're always going to have this part of the it's called Uruguero.
Oh, okay.
It's like there's, it's, that laughing.
Poor girl, I'm sorry.
She's used to that. She used to be shown. But it's an undercoat. It's a lateral cream to buff color.
Okay.
It can be more silver gray with a black and tan.
Okay.
The black and tan will have these same patterns though, but they'll have like tan dots. The cream color will go into the tan, into the black. The black is not a jet black. It's a black that is, you know, if you pull the undercoat, because you'll see a different color, and shaded all.
Oh, okay.
And the sesame is like if you imagine the black and tan, but just with black-tipped red hair, but in that same pattern.
Oh, okay.
And then we have a color that we don't show, but it's very popular with pet owners. It's cream, and it can go from almost white to much more ivory-colored. It's a dilute of the red color.
Oh, and it's, yeah, I don't think I've ever seen that color.
Oh, they're beautiful.
Wow.
And but we don't show them because the Kishu Inu, which is another Japanese Spitz breed, is required to be that color.
Okay.
You know, it's a bigger dog too, but it's, you know, they try not to, the only colors they seem to overlap is the white-faced red.
Okay.
And that's in a lot of the Spitz breeds.
Yeah, interesting, very interesting. And the Spitz breed always has the curled tail.
Yes, the erect ears and the curled tail when they're not being lazy.
Right.
She was expecting something else, I think.
Are you bored, lady? Huh? Are you bored, lady? You are. Oh, poor baby. So how popular is this breed?
This is a very popular breed in Japan. It is one of the, because
here
of the size.
Here in the United States, I don't care what they do in Japan. Here in the United States.
Yeah. Yes, I'll go into that. It all of a sudden has become much more popular. There's a dog meme that you see on the internet of this, you know, it's a really mischievous Shiba, and he makes all these odd faces, and you know, we get calls all the time, the people that want that dog.
Uh-huh.
And so they're gaining in popularity. Would I say they're up with Labradors? No.
Yeah.
They're not, and they probably never will be.
Mm-hmm.
But they are, sadly, for commercial kennels, do enjoy this breed because they're very hardy and easy breeders and
mm-hmm.
whelpers.
Mm-hmm.
So
yeah, that is unfortunate. That is unfortunate.
Mm-hmm.
So how often do you have to brush her?
They should be groomed, you know, brushed a couple of times a week.
Okay.
And then when the shedding season comes, you'll have some of that off. It's just to your advantage to do that.
Mm-hmm.
A good bath will start that, you know. But, yeah, once or twice a week you can brush them.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
so you don't have
keep
more hair.
Keep the nails back and, mm-hmm. you know, like your normal grooming, think,
right,
clean the
right,
ears out.
Right. So would this be a good dog for children?
It can be, but I wouldn't say, for first-time owners.
Okay.
All of mine love children,
uh-huh.
but I've worked very hard. If they're going to a good breeder that socializes their pups to children while they're still in that stage where that's going to take
adaptable.
And have the positive mm-hmm. interactions mm-hmm. with kids.
Right.
Mine love toddlers and everything,
well.
But some are a little, because they're such instinctual animals,
mm-hmm.
they sometimes, you know, when toddlers start, some of them don't have the patience.
Right. So then it would be a good dog for an elderly couple? What about apartments? Are they barkers?
Some people say they are. I have not had that a problem with mine.
Okay.
Or in my experience with uh-huh. many different, you
right,
know,
right.
Thing, you know, dogs. I will tell you, they can be when, if they're, you know, spoiled a little bit, they'll tell
mm-hmm.
you what's what. But for sure. But as a rule, they are a quiet dog. You can't have them in an apartment. They do need regular exercise.
Okay.
And when they're younger, you've got to keep them mentally active as well as physically active. It doesn't mean you have to run 10 miles with them, but they need regular exercise and something to keep their brain occupied. Good obedience class, teaching tricks, agility is a great way.
Mm-hmm.
A tired dog is a happy dog,
yes.
and a well-behaved dog.
Is a
dog.
Good dog. A tired dog is a good dog.
And we have many that are excelling in the barn hunt.
Oh, good.
And,
yeah.
And
well, they're hunters.
We have lure coursers too. We have, you know, where they pass the instinct test.
Wow.
So more and more people are starting to get into that, and
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
the breeders are working really hard. And I think it's a matter of time before those breeders will have it, where it's not such a touchy dog for.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Well, what health problems do they have?
Well, they can have loose patellas.
Okay.
They can have their certain.
That's the kneecap.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's not generally a serious thing, but you want to make sure anybody that you're going to get a dog from is testing their stock for that.
Okay.
You know, it is something that's for in the beginning. Was very prevalent in this breed.
Ooh, okay.
We also x-ray for hip dysplasia mm-hmm. and we do eye checks. We don't see a lot of eye problems other than we're starting to see an uptick in glaucoma.
Oh, my.
And that's a difficult one because
yes.
you don't. It's hard to really
you
diagnose
can't find it.
It
right, until they're
older.
Been bred. Yep.
And so we have seen a couple in the breeders that are working again,
mm-hmm.
working hard at identifying, trying to identify,
mm-hmm.
you know, where that's coming
yeah.
from.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
they're really doing a pretty good job all in all. It was different in the beginning because there wasn't a lot of knowledge about the
mm-hmm.
breed.
Mm-hmm. And there weren't a lot of them either.
No.
Right.
There weren't.
Right.
And I've had them since way before recognition.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, let's talk to Darin about his little Shar Pei. Now, you said they were recognized in 92.
Damn. Good boy. Yeah, in 92, we had Shar, you know, independent Chinese Shar Pei Club of America shows before that.
Well, how long have they actually been in this country?
They started to come in the late 60s, early 70s.
Okay.
But there was a Life magazine article in 74 that kind of kicked off the breed in this country because a gentleman in China named Matt Go Law, who was an official with the Hong Kong Kennel Club,
uh-huh.
wrote an open letter to the American public in Life magazine asking them to save this breed.
Oh.
And the breed was on the verge of extinction.
Wow.
Because in China, there wasn't there was issues with, you know, having enough food and everything for their people. Uh-huh. And so owning a dog was considered a luxury.
Well, maybe later, huh?
And so the government started taxing dog ownership, and that caused a lot of people to you know, do other things with their dogs and not reproduce them and have them. So the breed was on the verge of extinction, and he wrote this letter. And, you know, that added good points and bad points.
That's exactly right, because then everybody wanted one.
You know, there for a while, you know, we started seeing ads in, like, Neiman Marcus and things like this. Mm-hmm. And, you know, people were getting upwards to $10,000 for a puppy.
Yeah.
And then you get the people coming, well, you know, this is an investment. I can make some money here.
Uh-huh.
And, you know, that turned into a real issue, because then we were having all kinds of health problems. That were, people weren't being careful about.
Right.
So, thankful, when we were recognized by the American Kennel Club back in 1992, they came in the AKC at about 32, I think it was, somewhere in that range, on the popularity chart out of like 140 breeds at that time. Now we're back down into around the 100 range for popularity. So that actually is a good thing, because now the only people that are reproducing them are the people that really have an interest in...
that love the breed.
Yeah.
That's exactly right.
Improving it.
Yeah, because everybody and their brother had one, and now you hardly see any at all. It's an interesting breed. I mean, it's a very interesting breed. What actually were they bred for in China?
They were a farm utility dog. They, you know, we have people that have done herding aptitude tests with them successfully. We've had people that have done some hunting work with them. The larger males were used for wild boar in China. You know, they generally were for vermin control on the farm. So they, you know, they do just a little bit of everything. They can do a little bit of everything, whether or not
people
train them.
You know, it's like most dogs can do anything you want them to. It's just getting the humans in gear to do something, right? You say, oh, well, this dog was bred to do... I think the only one is the Pekingese that doesn't do anything. But every other breed wants to do something. Now, they have the double coat as well, right?
No, they're not supposed to.
They're not supposed... Oh, really?
No.
Oh, okay.
But
there's a different coat on them, right?
Yes.
Okay.
Shar Pei means sandy dog or sandy coat.
Oh.
Is what it translates as close as we can from Chinese.
Uh-huh.
And they are supposed to have a harsh texture to their coat.
Okay.
They're not supposed to have a double coat or an undercoat.
Okay, okay.
He is what we call a horse coat. So you can see, especially over his tail, the coat is very short and bristly.
Okay, okay.
And there's a longer, slightly longer coat called a brush coat.
Okay.
But neither coat is supposed to be in excess of an inch.
Oh, okay. Well, that's a pretty short coat.
Yeah.
Right.
Now, there are some what we call bear coats out there that are longer and tend towards the chow length. They start to look like chows.
Oh, wow.
And, you know, one of the unique characteristics of the breed is the blue-black tongue.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know if you can see here. Get a close-up on his mouth there. It's almost completely black. And his tongue's black.
Mm-hmm.
And that is a characteristic only shared with chow chows.
Right.
So obviously there's some common ancestry back there.
Yes.
So we do get throwbacks sometimes, you know, that you'll have a litter with a bear coat in it.
Okay, okay. So do they require very much exercise?
They are a well-muscled and athletic breed, and they do much better when they do get some exercise.
Okay.
I have had puppies in, you know, go to pet homes that are like apartments or townhouses and such, and they do fine in that situation. But, you know, it's always good to get them out for at least a walk.
Day. But they don't look like a very active dog. They look like a dog that would be content to sit and watch television and eat potato chips with you.
If you let them, yes, they will become couch potatoes.
Yeah.
But really, it does just about everything with me. He's a champion in AKC and UKC. He does obedience. He has obedience titles, agility, rally. He does scent work. And sometimes he goes along with our other dogs, you know, when we go out in the field for training them on spaniel hunt tests and stuff. So.
Oh, okay. So he's a hunt dog as well.
Well, there have been some dumb bunnies that have gotten in the yard, and he saw them before I did, and they didn't fare too well.
Okay. So, by the way, the dog's name is Really. He's not just saying Really as a word. The dog's name is Really.
His register name is I Am For Real, so he gets
okay,
tagged Really.
Okay, okay. So then this would be a good dog for an older couple as well, as children?
I would say if they were more experienced people, that, you know, this wasn't their first dog.
Okay.
When I sold puppies, it was written right in the contract that I would guarantee the temperament of the dog if they went and got an obedience class.
Okay, okay.
And, you know, it's kind of hard to enforce contracts sometimes.
Yes,
and
yes.
Say, you must go get an obedience. Well, this way, if something would happen.
Right.
That the dog would have to be put down because of a behavior issue. If they had gotten that obedience class, then I would refund some money.
And,
but
you know, obedience is good for all dogs. I mean, because people just don't understand. They just don't understand. So what health problems do these guys have?
There is a thing out, right? A lot of research has been done about Shar Pei fever, Shar Pei familiar fevers. And they've actually narrowed it down now. They've changed the name to Shar Pei autoimmune disease, spade.
Yeah.
And it is, as the name implies, an autoimmune disease that's kind of related to the wrinkling.
And, okay.
We are within weeks, I'm told, of having a genetic test available in the United States. The test is already available in Europe.
Yeah,
in
wonderful.
Sweden. And, you know, we're on the verge of getting that test here with Cornell University, and we're hoping that we can start cut back on the incidence a lot with that new test.
Yeah. So they too are a breed that has their own agenda.
Yes, they can be stubborn.
I needed to say that nicely.
Stubborn and independent.
Well, I didn't want to say that.
You think back to their history in China, and they were a utility farm dog, and they were a lot of
time. They needed to do their own job.
Yes.
Yes. And they knew what that job was.
Yes.
That's exactly right. That's exactly right. So the face is different than, well, obviously she's got a pointed nose, but they're mushy. They have like a mushy jaw. Is that for a particular reason that they have so much
padding on the face?
Yeah, right.
If you look,
they have fat faces.
If you look at the Shar Pei that came in from China, there were more what we call bone mouth that had less padding on the face.
Uh-huh.
But in America, we like our dogs soft and cuddly.
Oh,
and,
okay.
So the more padded faces, the more wrinkles were kind of encouraged. Because the American public liked that look.
Right. And you do have, with the wrinkling, you do have problems, skin problems, if you don't keep those wrinkles.
No, the skin problems are autoimmune.
Okay.
And they're not related to the cleanliness necessarily.
Okay. All right, very good. Well, I guess that's our program for this evening. We ran out of time. So for this evening, good night. Next month, we will have the Dog Training Club program on, so it will probably be some kind of performance that you will be seeing next month. So for this evening, good night.
About Dogs on BCTV is supported by the Berks County Kennel Club. and by the Berks County Dog Training Club.